No, no, no. It's Aarti. So just speak off, Aarti. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, we can cut. Yes.
Yes, yes. So everything we have with us today, and also we have with us today, and Sudhanna, very good. So we have CC versus DDP. With your permission, shall we begin?
Yes.
Each team has.
Is that the building?
I am Council CC1 and she is my co-Council CC2 on the behalf of Evelyn in the matter of Sada Shivbal Chandram to take up my answer. Your Lordship, I shall be speaker number 1 and my co-Council Chandram is speaker number 1. Your Lordship, Council seeks permission to present the facts of the case. The facts of the case herein are Mr. Sada Shivbal Chandram, a 25-year-old man, resided in the house next to Mr. Manoj Desai and became friendly with his elder daughter, Savita, aged 17. Studying in St. Anne's College and Junior College. Gradually, Mr. Balchandra and Savita developed a close relationship, and on 14th February 2009, Mr. Balchandra put up a proposal of marriage before Savita because she was about to turn 18 in 2 months, and they both decided to get married. On 30th June, Savita's sister Kasturi found out that Savita wanted to marry Mr. Balchandra, and later on the same day, Savita's intention to their father, Mr. Manoj Desai. Mr. Desai was against this marriage. To keep Savita away from Mr. Balchandra, he took her to their distant relative, Mr. Nand Kumar's house at Nandan, at Ranjangaon. On 1st July, Savita herself left the house of Mr. Nand Kumar and telephoned Mr. Balchandra to meet him. After that, they got married on the same day. Later, Mr. Balchandra was convicted under Section 362 of ICC. By both Metropolitan State Court and the Session Court after the complaint was made by Mr. Desai. In your English Honorable High Court, he has filed with us for his application. Now, if you are not to go to the facts of the case, now, counsel would like to move to the issue.
What is the sentence granted by the Session Court?
He has to be convicted under Section 362 of ICC.
What is the sentence? Punishment term of a year of
imprisonment. Sir, here it is only given that he was convicted under Section 362 of ICC by both Metropolitan Court and Session Court.
Okay.
In the fact it is given.
Okay.
Counsel has raised these 3 issues. The first issue is whether the consent of a minor who is about to attain the age of majority should be taken into consideration. Second, whether the act of the appellant should be considered as enticement. And third, whether the part played by the appellant amounts to taking out of the meaning of proper guardianship. Your Lordship, the first issue will be dealt by me and the last issue will be dealt by my co-counsel. Your Lordship, the first issue being that whether the consent of a minor who is about to attain the age of majority should be taken into consideration. Here, counsel would like to refer the facts of Aarti. In paragraph number 1 of the case, it is stated that Savita was a 17-year-old girl and student of junior college, residing in Mumbai. Also, as per the facts, first this landmark judgment has almost similar fact as of the facts of R case. In this case also, the girl was on the verge of attaining the child. Ace is a female or a person of unsound mind. Out of the thinking of proper guidance of such minor or person of unsound mind, without the benefit of such guidance, said to be left such minor or person of unsound mind. The interpretation for the term implies in the definition of kidnapping from lawful guardianship and the specification of a fighting involves the idea of influence or influence by giving rise to hope or desire.
Where are you reading this from? Definition of enticing.
Accepted his proposal. So, Your Lordship, here we can conclude that there has been no inducement from the part of Mr. Balchandra. Your Lordship, if a minor who is on the verge of attaining the age of majority abandons her lawful guardianship without any promise or offer or inducement from the accused, it cannot be said that an offense of kidnapping is made out. In order to bring home conviction for kidnapping, there must be a proof of accused having done something which led to the girl going out of the keeping of her guardianship. And Your Lordship, we can notice in the facts of our case, there has been no such incident which tantamounts to inducement or allurement. MRC, can you please show page number 12 of first judgment as Varadarajan versus State of Madras? Page number 12. Here, is it there? Here, counsel would again like to refer the judgment of S. Varadarajan versus State of Madras. On page number 6, can you show please first page number 6? On page number 6, it is mentioned that there is not a word in the deposition of girl from which an inference could be drawn that she left the house of her relative at the instance or even a suggestion of the accused, which is completely similar to the fact of our case. And Your Lordship, on page number 12 now. The Honorable Supreme Court held that no offense under Section 363 has been established against the accused and that he is therefore entitled to acquittal. Now, here counsel would again like to refer a judgment, Manoj versus State of Madhya Pradesh, given by High Court of Madhya Pradesh, cited in the year 2016. In this judgment too, the girl was of the age 17 and a half years. That means she was about to turn 18, which is similar to the facts of our case. Please show page number 17 of this judgment. The second judgment. Second judgment. This is third. Page number 14. On page number 14, we can see that
there has been no active participation by accused, which led to the prosecutrix to move out of her parental house. Rather, it was found that prosecutrix on her own accord left her parental home and joined the accused. The High Court held that it cannot be said that prosecutrix was enticed by the accused, and hence the accused was not charged under Section 363 of IPC. So, Your Lordship, now here counsel wants to convey that the basic ingredient of enticement is missing from the facts of our case. Hence, we urge that the Savita's consent should not, Savita's decision was not enticed by Mr. Balchandra. Now, if Your Lordship is well contented with both these issues, my counsel will deal with the last
issue. No, tell me one thing. Firstly,
yes,
what have you filed? What pleading, what proceedings have you filed before us today? What jurisdiction are you invoking of this court?
For the acquittal of charges made under Section 363.
I understand, but what you claim to have filed an appeal.
Filed an appeal for acquittal.
Okay. Under what provision have you filed an appeal?
Counsel, please, ignorance.
Okay. Kindly open your criminal procedure code and note down this question. Tell me under what provision have you filed an appeal. I want to see that. You can address that of the during your rebuttal. Apart from that, coming to the facts of the case, your main contention was that Savita is although a minor or on the verge of attaining majority, her consent was given, and on that basis she was aware of what she was doing, and she was old enough to be aware of what are the consequences of action, and therefore her consent should be considered, and that cannot be considered taking away. That is your argument.
Mine is enticed.
Tell me, is there any distinction laid down in the definition of a minor or a person, or a difference between a person who is on the verge of attaining majority and who is a minor? And whether if a person just on the verge of attaining majority, their consent is still a good consent in the eyes of law, as compared to a consent of a person who still has time to attain majority.
Your Lordship, I would like to say that a minor girl and a girl with borderline age should not be treated in the same way, as there is enough difference in the level of maturity of the minor and the girl.
Apart from your arguments, on what basis are you making this statement? Is there any provision of law in your favor? Are there any judgments in your favor regarding this point?
So, as per the Rajan versus State of Madras in our favor, and this Manoj versus State of Madhya Pradesh is also in our favor.
What is the distinction laid down by the Supreme Court in S. Varda Rajan regarding this aspect?
They have said that the girl was on the verge of attaining majority, and that's why her consent should be taken into consideration.
Are these the words of the Supreme Court?
Sorry to disturb. CC1 have consumed your time. Hello?
And apart from assuming that she has given her consent, the word consent is not found anywhere in the provisions of 361. Under the provision of Section 361, there's no word consent. As such, the words are taking away or enticing. Now, the question before us is whether the accused has taken away or enticed her. If that is the case, if he has taken away or enticed her, or if he hasn't, his presence is essential for this crime to be committed. If he wasn't there, she would have never been taken away.
So, my co-counsel will deal with the argument regarding the taking thing.
You argued specifically that there has been no inducement on behalf of your client.
Yes.
Now, without her client being there, the girl wouldn't have run away.
But sir, it's not the case. She herself called him on that day.
She would have run away a day prior, or she would have run away 5 minutes before or 5 minutes afterwards. Why did she have to run away with him? The fact that she's running away with him is a reasonable apprehension before us. And that is the reason the two courts below us have held this. Because without him, there would be no taking away or enticing.
Yes, Your Lordship.
Sorry, continue to this.
Sir, CC1 have consumed her time.
Yes, we'll complete. So, are you conceding to this?
Sir, I would like to add that there has been no prior inducement on the girl. And it is on that day only she left with him. There has been no such actions by Mr. Balchandra before that he has induced her or he has induced her or allured her. He simply asked her to marry him. He did not give any futuristic promise in return.
But the point is that without him, she wouldn't have run away. And if there was no prior inducement, are you saying that there was inducement on the day of the marriage? Is the promise to marriage a real promise? Was it an honest promise?
Yes, sir.
Are they still married today?
Yes, sir.
Is that your presumption or is there in the fact sheet?
It's my presumption, but it is there that they got married on the same day.
And are they still married today?
I'm not much aware with this information.
Okay, fine. We'll let your co-counsel argue. You please answer my query as to whether this is under what provision we filed this appeal.
Okay, sir.
Yes. And one more thing, I'm sorry, regarding this 2016 Madhya Pradesh High Court, what were the charges? What were the facts of that case?
Case also, the girl was of the age of 17 and a half years.
No, what were the charges? What was the accused charged with?
He was also punished under Section 363 of IPC for the kidnapping.
Only 363 or any other provisions also included?
Sir, I am aware with only 363 of IPC.
Check the judgment again and confirm that. Let your co-counsel argue.
CC2, you may begin.
Yes. May it please the Honorable Court, I am counsel CC2 and I shall be dealing with the third issue. Now that my co-counsel has already shed light on first two issues, this counsel seeks permission to move to the third issue.
Yes, don't take permission. Okay. Unless you stop, please go ahead.
The third issue is whether the part played by the appellant amounts to taking out of the keeping of lawful guardianship. Here, counsel would again like to refer to Section 361 IPC. Section 361 IPC states that whoever takes or entices any minor under 16 years of age if a male or under 18 years of age if a female out of the keeping of or a person of unsound mind out of the keeping of lawful guardian of such minor or person of unsound mind without the consent of such lawful guardian, then it is said that it has kidnapped such minor or a person of unsound mind. It is thus seen that for an offense of kidnapping, enticing and taking away minor out of the keeping of lawful guardianship are an essential ingredients. Now, Your Lordship, if we look into the facts of our case, on 1st July 2019, Savita herself left the house of Mr. Nandakumar and telephoned Mr. Balchandra and asked him to meet her. Here, when Mr. Balchandra arrived there with his dad's car, Savita voluntarily, without any force by Mr. Balchandra, sat in his car. Then they both went straight to Siddhivinayak Mandir and got married and later traveled to different places. Now, Your Lordship, as we can see that Savita voluntarily abandoned her protective shell of lawful guardianship. There has been no part played by Mr. Balchandra in the action of Savita to leave the house of Mr. Nandakumar and to go with him. He merely accompanied her. Your Lordship, there is a distinction between the term taking and allowing a minor to accompany a person. The two expressions are not synonymous, though we would like to guard ourselves from laying down that in no conceivable circumstance can the two be regarded as meaning the same thing for the purposes of Section 361 IPC. We would limit ourselves to a case like the present, where a minor alleged to have been taken away by the person left her protection of lawful guardian, knowing and having the capacity to know the full import of what she was doing, voluntarily joins the accused person. In such a case, we cannot say that the accused can be said to have taken her away out of the keeping of lawful guardianship. Your Lordship, counsel would like to refer a judgment here. It is Praveen Prakahar and Anothers versus State Government of NCT of Delhi and Anothers, given by Honorable Justice P.K. Basin, cited in the year 2019. In this judgment also, the girl was about to turn 18, which is similar to the facts of our case. And also, she had gone with the accused out of her own free will and had married to him also on her own volition. MRC, could you please go to page number 20? Hello?
What court is this?
Sorry?
Which court is this?
Case Praveen Prakar and another versus state government of NCT of Delhi and another.
Which court?
Delhi High Court. It is clearly mentioned here also that the girl had reached the age of discretion and was on the verge of attaining majority. When she left her home and went with the accused, no role was played by him. So it cannot be said that the accused has kidnapped her, as there has been no taking out of lawful guardianship, and the court held the decision in favor of the accused. Similarly, in our case, no role was played by Mr. Balchandra in the action of Savita to leave the house of Mr. Nandakumar. So it cannot be said that Mr. Balchandra has kidnapped her, as there has been no taking from lawful guardianship. Your Lordship, your counsel would like to refer another judgment, Deep Chand versus State, given by Honorable Justice D. Bhandari of Delhi High Court, cited in the year 1999. In this case also, both the girls were minor. MRC, could you please go to page number 22? The facts of this case states that both the minor girls had voluntarily gone to the railway station and accompanied the accused. As a matter of fact, these girls persuaded the accused to take them for outing. The accused did not even go to take them from their residence, which is similar to our case. Here, the fact, Delhi High Court held that the basic ingredient of Section 361 IPC are not present. And the
which
facts
court is this?
Delhi High Court.
This is also Delhi High Court.
Yes. So the court did not convict the accused under Section 363 IPC. Similarly, in our case, there has been no taking of Savita by Mr. Balchandra. So one of the basic ingredients of Section 361 is not present. Here, counsel would again like to refer to the landmark judgment of S. Varadarajan versus State of Madras, given by Supreme Court, cited in the year 1964. As my co-counsel has already mentioned that, in this case also, the girl was on the verge of attaining majority and she had voluntarily abandoned the protective shell of lawful guardianship and gone with the accused. MRC, could you please go to page number 6?
I want to say we've seen this. We have seen this. I'm clear with your arguments regarding S. Varadarajan.
Okay. It is stated that she willingly accompanied the accused and the law did not cast upon him the duty of taking her back to her father's house or even of telling her not to accompany him. Here, Supreme Court held that no offense under Section 363 has been established against the accused and that he is therefore entitled for acquittal. Similarly, in our case, Savita willingly accompanied Mr. Balchandra and the law did not cast upon him the duty of taking her back to her lawful guardian. So there has been no taking of Savita by Mr. Balchandra out of the keeping of lawful guardian. Your Lordship, for the offense of kidnapping, two essential ingredients have to be fulfilled. First is enticing and the second is taking out of the keeping of lawful guardian. But both the ingredients are missing in the facts of our case. Now, Your Lordship, the counsel wants to convey that in our case also, Savita was about to attain the age of majority and she voluntarily went out of her lawful guardianship. So her consent should not be completely held immaterial. Mr. Balchandra neither enticed Savita nor did he take her away out of the keeping of lawful guardianship. So counsel urges the Honorable High Court, Mr. Balchandra should not be convicted under Section 363 IPC. If your Lordship is well contented with the argument, counsel would like to
we'll leave the prayers aside. First, tell me one thing. Do you have the answer? What under what provision have you filed the appeal as claimed by you?
Provisions of Section 361 and...
That is the provision for the punishment. I mean, under what provision of the Criminal Procedure Code, CRPC, have you filed the appeal? Are you aware of that?
Of kidnapping?
You said you filed an appeal against the order of the Sessions Court, which confirms the order of the Magistrate Court. You have come before the High Court. You're praying for acquittal of your client and overturning of the sentence. Now, under what provisions, what jurisdiction of this court are you invoking? What provisions of the CRPC have you invoked?
Counsel, please ignorance.
Okay. Now, tell me one more thing. You can read that. You can find that out, like your co-counsel during your rebuttal. You can answer this query. Now, again, you are harping on the fact about the girl's willingness and the girl's consent. Now, in the Vardarajan judgment, which you all are both so heavily relying upon, those are facts of those cases. Even if they are very similar, today before this court, we have facts of this case. We have to consider the evidence in detail and record, just because in that judgment they've held that so-and-so. And also, it's a very old, it's almost a 50-year-old judgment. So, leaving that judgment aside, tell me one thing. Does the willingness of the minor matter? Should we consider the willingness of the minor? And are you admitting that even if there was willingness, she was taken out of the lawful guardianship of her uncle, whoever he was?
Minor of a borderline age, in that case, willingness should be considered because she's just about to turn 18 and she has developed enough maturity as compared to minor below the age of 17.
I understand, but does the law include this? Does the law, is it anywhere included in the statute? Is there any way protecting this? Apart from this Vardarajan judgment, do you have any arguments to support this?
Yes, even in Praveen Prakar and another's versus state government of Delhi and another's, it is a case of 2013, so it is much recent. And here also, the appellant was acquitted.
What about taking away from the lawful guardianship? Are you admitting that she was taken away from the lawful guardianship?
No, she was not taken away from lawful guardianship.
Why do you say so?
Because she went there, she herself telephoned Mr. Balchandra and she voluntarily sat in his car. So she also wanted to marry him and there was no taking.
But she was a minor. She was given in the care and custody of her uncle. Without the consent of her uncle or her father, she was taken away.
But she was not just a minor. She was a minor of a borderline age. So that makes a difference.
I don't see any distinction like this under law. It is very specific. It's only 18 years. Do not say 18 years of people just about to turn 18 years. So I'm not ready to accept the argument unless you show me something else. And when it comes to Delhi High Court, Delhi High Court is very, firstly, is that judgment binding upon this court? Do I have to follow Delhi High Court judgment? And secondly, in one of the judgments you cited, there the girls are voluntarily gone to meet the accused.
Yeah, in that judgment.
That is not the case. Here the boy has, the accused has voluntarily gone and said and taken her away and then taken her temple. Would she have done all of this without him? I'm asking the same question again.
But the boy has not gone and take, Savita herself telephoned her, Mr. Balchandra. So here the boy did not go and asked her to come with her, to come with him.
She Savita telephoned to him. She telephoned to him, could be for anything. She telephoned to him, I'm staying here. There's nothing, there's no evidence on record to prove that.
But then she voluntarily went in his car without any force. So that means she also agreed.
Which is why I'm asking you that there is no requirement that she has to be forced. She can go voluntarily, but does that not amount to enticing?
No, if she has gone voluntarily, then that doesn't amount to enticing.
Any judgments to support this?
Yeah, Varadarajan, Praveen Prakar, and Deep Chand versus.
What does Varadarajan say voluntarily leaving?
In Varadarajan also, both the girl and the boy wanted to marry, and she voluntarily went with him. And then
what did the Supreme Court decide upon voluntarily leaving?
That there has been no enticement and taking, and therefore the boy was not convicted under Section 363.
Okay. Yes, responded.
Yes.
Time off. Teams, now the other team can start.
I cannot hear you, Aarti.
Am I audible now, sir?
Yes.
The other team can start now.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Good morning. The council seeks permission to refer honorable bench collectively as your lordship.
Yes, you are before a single judge. So you don't have to refer to us collectively. Yes. I'm only one judge.
Yes, okay. Much obliged. The counsel has the humble pleasure of appearing before the Honorable Bombay High Court. I'm the counsel representing the respondent in the matter of Sadashiv versus the state of Maharashtra. I shall be addressing the court for 10 minutes and will be dealing with issue 1. Subsequently, I shall yield the floor to my counsel, who shall argue for 14 minutes and will deal with the issue 2. I respectfully reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal. If your lordships are clear with the counsel's scheme of presentation, the counsel speaks to permission to state the facts of the case.
Yes, need not ask my permission for everything. Go ahead till I stop you. Don't ask.
Okay, yes. Mr. Manoj Desai resided with his wife and two daughters, Savita, 17 years of age, and Kasturi, 14 years of age. Mr. Sadashiv Balachandra, 25 years of age, was a neighbor, was fired from his job. A few months before, Savita became friendly with Mr. Sadashiv. The balconies allowed them to have conversation with each other. On 14th Feb 2019, Mr. Sadashiv proposed to Savita. He turned down the proposal. He then further enticed and persuaded her to get married to him. She agreed, being innocent. Kasturi saw Savita and Balachandra talking to each other at 10 p.m. in the night. Kasturi then questioned her sister about the same, to which she replied she wanted to get married to him. Savita also said he is currently fired from his job, but he would get a job, which is nice, and he would get nice payment from him. And he has also promised to take her to a film when he gets his first paycheck. So her intentions, Savita's intentions were communicated by Kasturi to her father, and he showed discontent. And to protect her daughter, and to protect his daughter, Mr. Manoj Desai took her daughter to Ranjangaon, to a distant relative, Nand Kumar. On the next day, that is 31st June 2019, Savita left the house of Mr. Nand Kumar at about 10. She then telephoned Mr. Balachandra and they took off in a car, and then immediately they got married. Then after that, they went to several places like Kolhapur, Belgaon and Goa. And finally at Goa, they were found that the police were investigating the kidnapping of Mr. Manoj Desai's daughter, Savita. They were to Bombay on 15th, 2019, and Mr. Sadashiv was charged under Section 363 of Indian Penal Code, and then he was convicted by both Metropolitan and Magistrate Sessions Court. The counsel seeks permission for your lordship to proceed with the first issue. Issue 1. Whether the appealant took or enticed the prosecutrix, that is Savita. I would refer to Section 361 of IPC. Whoever takes or entices any minor under 16 years if a male and 18 years if a female, or any person of unsound mind out of the keeping of the lawful guardian of such minor or the person of unsound mind without the consent of such guardian, is said to have kidnapped that person. So here in Section 361, we get two essential ingredients of the section. The first is taking or enticing, and the second is taking out of the lawful guardianship, taking out of the lawful guardianship of the guardian without permission. One of the essential ingredients of Section 361 ICC is taking out of the minor under the age of 18 years if a female. So, quoting from the fact, it was the appealant who proposed to her, and on being rejected, he further persuaded her in such a manner that that she agreed to marry him. In the deposition of Savita, it was found that he was luring her by saying he was going to have a secure job and income. He also promised to take her out of the motel, out to a movie with his first paycheck. He was implicitly giving her hope of a life with him by maintaining stable financial position. The accused's enticement was the motive cause for Savita to abandon the protection of a lawful guardian.
Please proceed.
Okay, so for this and the counsel, so the counsel of the appellant said that she voluntarily sat into the car. She did everything voluntarily. But section 363 clearly states you don't have the voluntary or force is completely immaterial to the contents of section 363. Section 363 nowhere states that if she goes on voluntarily or if she's forced, is completely immaterial. This
I
end the issue first.
Sorry?
I completed issue one. That's it.
Okay. Is there any other bone of contention? What's the bone of contention for your argument? Any judgments to support your claim?
No. My co-counsel will refer to all the judgments.
Okay, so tell me one thing. Firstly, are you aware whether the proceedings filed or an appeal filed is maintainable or not? According to you, is the appeal maintainable?
The counsel seeks ignorance.
Okay, so you're admitting to that appeal being maintainable. Now, regarding this voluntary and consent of force, like you said, is immaterial. Is there any judgment to support this? Because what is your argument regarding S. Varadarajan? You haven't dealt with that.
Yes. I would refer to the judgment of Kunjipanju versus state, that is by Kerala High Court. It is clearly stated in para 4, line 4. It is clearly stated that...
What year was the judgment?
Sorry?
What year was the judgment passed in?
It was passed in 1987, I think.
You think? Yes. Don't you have it before you? Haven't you produced it before the court?
No.
Have you produced it before the court?
The counsel please ignorance.
I'm asking whether you have produced it. Yes or no?
Yes. I have produced it.
So can I see the judgment?
Yeah, sure.
Can you tell me the page number?
Yes, page number 4, para 4. Para 4. It clearly stated that. So the question is whether the girl went away willingly. So the question whether the girl went willingly with the accused or taken forcibly with him was immaterial under the law of offence under Section 363.
Can we go down? What does it say ahead? What were the facts of this case?
Uh,
I don't accept. If you don't know the facts, don't show me any judgments. I don't know. How do I read this? How am I supposed to understand? Yes. Okay. Any other argument? What about S. Varadarajan? Kerala High Court is of a High Court. S. Varadarajan is a Supreme Court. Also in prior in time. Has Kerala High Court considered as Varadarajan? Has this Kerala judgment considered as Varadarajan judgment?
So counsel takes ignorance.
Have you read this Kerala High Court judgment?
Yeah.
So then if you've read it, then can you tell me whether it is considered as Varadarajan judgment? Is it considered? Has Varadarajan been referred to in this judgment, Kerala High Court judgment?
Yeah. Yes.
Do me a favor, read this Kerala High Court judgment and tell me what is the facts. Till then your co-counsel will deal with the other arguments. And in a sir rejoinder, you can tell me. Read the judgment, tell me what the judgment is about.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next counsel. You may begin.
May I please, the Honorable Court, I am counsel 2 on behalf of the respondent in the case of Sadashiv Balchandra versus State of Maharashtra. The counsel seeks permission of your lordships to proceed with second issue, which relates to whether such enticement was to move her out of the guardianship. Proceeding with the first limb of my argument, in case of Sadashiv Balchandra versus State of Maharashtra, it is seen that Sadashiv, on the prema kathai of the matter, was enticing her by promising that he will marry her, and also he said that he will get a secure job later in a few months' time. Also, he will take her to a movie when he receives his first pay. He was giving her hopes of a life that she will have if she continues to be in a relationship with him, or what the future will lead to. Under section 361 of the IPC, the words lawful guardian in this section include any person lawfully entrusted with the care or custody of such minor or the other person. In our case, the uncle, Mr. Nand Kumar, is the lawful guardian, but he still continues to be under the lawful guardianship of the father, that is Mr. Manoj Desai. And as per the facts in point number 11, it is stated that thereafter she went to that road herself. Mr. Balchandra drove his father's car and had arrived at the place which Savita mentioned before she got there. As per the facts, the road was in the vicinity of Savita and not Mr. Balchandra. And also, Dabhil to Ranjangaon requires 6 hours and 15 minutes of travel before Savita from the telephone booth reached the road which is in her vicinity. Sadashiv Balchandra was already reached before her. That means
it I've been... under the facts. Don't repeat the facts. It's the fourth time hearing the facts. Is there any new fact which you're telling me? What is your argument?
MRC, could you please turn to page 6 of the compendium?
Have you read this judgment?
Yes, sir.
What does the judgment say about Varadarajan?
S. Varadarajan case. S. Varadarajan was acquitted in the case because it was not proved that he has taken her out of the lawful guardianship of a father.
And what has happened in this judgment?
In this case, the guy, the 26-year-old guy, took the girl with him with the intention to marry her, but subsequently it was proved that it was without the consent of it, and therefore it was under section 363 and 366 he was charged.
But did they get married in this case?
Yes, they did got married, and they lived as husband and wife for 3 months.
So what is the difference between the facts of this case and our case, or what are the similarity in the facts of this case and our case?
In our case, the charges are same except for 366. He has been charged in our case.
I mean the facts, not the charges. What are the difference in the facts?
Facts is that he was in a minute. I'm a bit confused with this.
Do not cite judgment if you don't know the facts. I told your co-counsel as well.
No, I just got confused.
Okay, what do you want to show me the judgment? Why did you open this? Show me. What do you want to show me?
Can you please scroll it down a bit? Follow the another highlight. Not this. A bit more. The other highlight.
You want this page only, right?
Just a second, yeah. Page number 6. Page number 6, first paragraph itself, it says, I am of the opinion, it starts with that. Page number 6. Exactly, yeah, this one. In Chatan Kunju,
where is this quoted from? Where is this quoted from?
Chatan Kunju Kunju versus State.
No. This quote. See, can you see the inverted comma at the start? Can you just go up one page?
This was from the judge, sir.
Aarti, can you go up a page up? Slowly. Scroll up. Up.
No, page number 5. Page 5.
Go to the previous page. Wait.
Brandon B stated the law in R versus Oliver.
Please read.
Can you please move to page 6? He stated that it is, however, equally clear that if a girl acting under his persuasion leaves her father's house, although he is not present at that moment, yet if he avails himself of that leaving, which took place at his persuasion, that would be taking her out of her father's possession, because the persuasion will be the motive cause of her leaving. Again, although she may not leave at the appointed time, and although he may not wish that she should have left at a particular time, yet if the findings she was left, he avails himself of that to induce her to continue away from her father's custody. In my judgment, he is also guilty if the persuasion operated on her mind so as to induce her to leave.
So, the
motive cause of leaving was because he promised her to marry, and also he gave her hopes that she will have a comfortable life, and because of the post, the respectable post he was about to get, and the secured payment that he was to get.
That is okay. Those are facts established. Mm-hmm. This is the third time I'm hearing this from you. But so what? In the end, when she is of a minor age, she knows, is she not of a exact minor age? She's about to attain majority in a few months. And she's aware of what? She's mature enough to take her decisions, as argued by the other side. What is your response to that? If she, what about her maturity? What about her willingness to go with him? Where is the force or where is the enticing?
Never in the past it has been stated that it was from her side that she wanted to marry him, or she persuaded him or went to him, or that she wanted.
Your co-counsel read the facts where she specifically argued that first she refused to marry, but then the second time she agreed to marry.
Because he further persuaded her, and we don't know how he persuaded her. So maybe we can assume that for the time being that he might have shown some life after the relationship would move to the another stage.
Okay, so?
So that induced her in such a way to give the sense of security that she will lead a happy and comfortable life.
That he gave her 6 months before. What about July? Inducement has to be just before.
Because 30th June at 10 a.m., Kasturi found both of them talking, and there she mentioned about it that she wanted to marry him, and they were having a conversation regarding marriage. And on 1st July 2019, she left with him. So the major implication in this is that prior to leaving, she was communicating to Bal Chandra which firmly establishes that she wanted to marry him on his persuasion and the promises that he has made to her.
What is your bone of what is your argument? I still haven't understood. So what you're just telling me the facts. What is the point you're trying to make?
That her leaving was because of the persuasion that Mr. Balchandra did on her.
Therefore, what? Where is the law supporting you? What about Aishwarya Rajan?
Aishwarya Rajan, it laid emphasis on the taking out of the guardianship, whereas it didn't much consider enticement part.
Other side has specifically made a statement before me that it considered the enticement part. They read something from that judgment which talks about enticing. I've asked them to read it and tell me where it is. If you have the judgment, if the other side can share it, please read the Aishwarya Rajan judgment and in your rebuttal, then deal with it. Brush to the judgment. That is all?
Yes, 10 minutes are up. DD2.
Is that all?
Yes. No, I'd like to move to the prayer.
No, it's okay. I know your prayer will be dismissed the appeal. Okay, I'm asking you again. Is it an appeal or what is it? And if it is an appeal, under what provisions is this filed?
It is under section 374, subsection 2 of the CRPC 1973.
You have CRPC with you?
Yes, I do have it.
Please read that.
Any person convicted on a trial held by sessions judge or an additional sessions judge or on a trial held by any other court in which a sentence of imprisonment for more than 7 years has been passed against him or against any other person convicted at the same trial may appeal to the High Court.
Does this mean that was the trial conducted in the sessions court?
Yes, it was both sessions court as well. Magistrate.
The trial was conducted in sessions court.
It was.
Then what happened in the magistrate court?
It convicted. No.
So where was the trial conducted? Where was the trial conducted?
Yes.
Where was the trial conducted?
It is just a moment. It is given in the facts that they were brought to Mumbai on 15th of July. Mr. Sadashiv.
I'm asking you a simple question. When a trial is conducted, how many times the trial conducted?
Once maybe.
Once. Right? You don't know.
Not much aware of it.
Okay. Find that out. Answer in the rebuttal. Okay. Let the team CC give their rebuttal.
Hello, your rebuttal time will start now.
Sir, they have mentioned that they don't know how he persuaded her, but they are saying that they have assumed that he must have enticed her by giving futuristic promises. But now it is nowhere mentioned in the facts that Mr. Balchandra has told Savita that he was going to soon be appointed respectable post and would be having a secured source of income. As per the facts, all this was told by Savita to her sister Kasturi, as their father has already known about lower financial condition of Mr. Balchandra. And just to convince her sister not to tell their father about Savita's intention to marry Mr. Balchandra, all this was told by Savita and not by Mr. Balchandra. So there has been no enticement by the part of Mr. Balchandra.
Okay. You tell me how Vardarajan deals with this enticement bit.
So they have mentioned that there has been no enticement.
I understand, but how do they say that? Do they only say one sentence, there was no enticement, full stop?
Sir, can I come to that point later?
Okay. First, you tell me, is this an appeal? Have you filed an appeal?
Yes, sir.
If you have filed an appeal, under what provision have you filed an appeal?
Sir, my learned friend has already mentioned under section 374, but I am not much aware with.
So, according to the trial was conducted in the sessions court?
He was convicted by the session court. I am not much aware.
Where was the trial conducted?
In Metropolitan Magistrate Court.
That's 374. give a right to appeal to someone under for trial conducted in the magistrate court to the high court?
I'm not much aware with this information.
Then 374, I don't think so is the right provision. Your appeal is only not maintainable. Under what provision you file the appeal?
Council 6.
Okay.
Is ignorance.
Yes. Go ahead to the other point.
Sir, now they have mentioned that he took her, but as your lordship, counsel has already urged that Savita's consent should not be completely held immaterial, as she was going to attain age of majority. We have already given enough references of judgment wherein honorable judges have considered the consent of the girl with borderline ages and held that if a girl with borderline age abandons her lawful guardianship with her own consent, on it will not be considered as taking out of the keeping of lawful guardianship, and merely because he accompanied her, it cannot be held that he kidnapped her or he enticed her or he took her away.
So according to you, just because she's on the verge of attaining majority, though not a major, still a minor, but on the verge of attaining majority, that does not amount to taking away or enticing.
Sir, I am telling that there has been no such incident that where he persuaded her or said that you come, I will take you some this place, or she herself
that
left the house.
With. If he wasn't there in this picture, she wouldn't have run away. You are admitting that she was taken out of the lawful guardianship. You are admitting that she's under 18. Let's go step by step. You are admitting that she's under 18.
Yes, sir.
You are admitting
she's on
that
the
she was the lawful guardianship of her lawful guardian.
Yes.
You are admitting that she wasn't in the lawful guardianship after she ran away.
Yes.
So she was taken out of the lawful guardianship. The only question arises is whether she was taken away or enticed.
Okay, she wasn't taken away. Or
she was on the verge of attaining majority and she gave consent. There was willingness, there was no force. All that is immaterial. The question was she taken away or enticed by the accused?
Sir, let us come to the first point, enticed. There has been no enticement by Mr. Balchandra. He has not enticed her. They are saying that he promised her or he proposed her, but he just asked her to marry him. He did not say that I will do this for you and I will do that for you if you'll get married to me. He just said that I want to marry you. She also accepted his proposal. So there has been no enticement. And by only
didn't
saying that
buy
I will
sarees?
Make you...
Didn't he buy her sarees?
Sir, after that, he bites sari when they went.
I told I'll get you sardis and everything, I'll take you. That is enticing. How are you saying it's not enticing, getting married?
But sir, there has been...
not turned 18, who does not know the difference, who not led an adult life. She must be wanting to get away of her father's strictures. And this guy must have given her, enticed her, saying, I'll get you married, I'll take care of you. That's not enticing.
This guy must have, but it is not there in the facts.
Firstly, who's this guy? Both the judges are arguing this guy.
Mr. Balchandra has not, it is not there in the facts that he, Mr. Balchandra has enticed her. It is nowhere mentioned. And if they are saying that she told Savita herself, it was told to Savita by Mr. Balchandra that he is going to get a respectable post and a secured source of income. But it is also not mentioned in the fact anywhere that he has told this to Savita. It may
Thanks,
be that sir. She also want. It may I?
Please continue.
It may be the case that she also, as she also wanted to marry Mr. Balchandra, she can say all these things to her sister just to convince her that she should not tell this to their father until she is attaining the age of maturity.
This is what I'm trying to tell you. What she says and what she does is immaterial as per the law. As per the law, if you're under 18 and you're taken away from the lawful guardianship, it is amounts to kidnapping. In those facts, in Vardharajan's facts, they said it wasn't enticing because that girl in Vardharajan was of a mature age. The Vardharajan girl was of a mature age and she did not, and that guy didn't entice her takeaway. You show me something on record is showing that it's not taken away or enticed. Any law, any other legal provision that this, what is not amounting to taking away or enticing?
Sir, I'm not much aware with the all others law, but I am saying that if we consider the fact of this case also, there has been no enticement. And if you are saying that the girl was mature in Vardharajan, it was also the case
never
that she was also...
Never addressed the court by saying you.
It is not there in the Vardharajan also that the girl was mature. It was there that she was also on the verge of attaining majority.
Okay.
And here also the girl was on the verge of attaining majority.
Have you, are you aware of Mens Rea?
Yes. Intention.
So, is there any Mens Rea in the present case?
So, on the part of Mr. Balchandra?
Yes, obviously. He's the accused, right?
Sir, I don't think so.
Don't think so? What do you think so then?
Sir, there is no. It is not mentioned in the facts.
Mens Rea is supposed to be inferred from the facts. They don't mention Mens Rea.
Sir, it is there that he wanted to marry him, but it is the case that she also wanted to marry him.
So the question is, whose Mens Rea has to be considered? Okay, and yes, some of your arguments. I understood your point. Okay, some of your arguments.
Sir, I am done.
Okay, can you brief your can you put forth your argument finally? What is your argument?
Oh, sir, it is nowhere mentioned in the facts that Mr. Balchandra has told Savita that he was soon to be appointed at a respectable post and would have a secured source of income. As per the facts, all this was told by Savita to her sister Kasturi, as their father had already known about the lower financial condition of Mr. Balchandra, and just convinced her sister not to tell their father about Savita's intention to marry Mr. Balchandra. All this was told by Savita and not by Mr. Balchandra. And also, sir, mere the fact that he accompanied her, it cannot be said that he has kidnapped her or he has took her away.
Okay.
Other team, we go to the time. Hello?
Yes, yes, we are there.
You want to rebuttal?
No, we don't.
What about the judgment? You'll read the Kerala High Court judgment.
We have finished half of it.
Fine. Can we wind up?
Okay. So, sir, can you total up the marks till that? I will introduce you.
One minute, beta. I just want to see something.
Yes, yeah, sure.
Okay, so
can I say something?
Should I mark them first or should I give them the review first? What do you all prefer, participants?
So review.
Once a review, I didn't hear.
Review.
Okay, you want to review first? Okay, so CC1. But firstly, when I take out of team code, just introduce yourself and tell me what year you are in.
Sir, I just finished my first year without giving second semester's exam.
Okay. So, means you are in the first year right now.
Yes.
What's your name?
Sir, I am not supposed to reveal, but it is Sheetal Mishra.
Okay. So, Sheetal, you should have all, actually, these are messages for all four of you all, but Sheetal, you argued well. You were at least confident of the points you're arguing on. But the thing is that your research, apart from S. Vardarajan, was very incomplete. Just because you have one judgment in your favor, does not mean that you have to end your arguments over there itself. You have to make sure that your other arguments also are strong. And just by relying, and if you're relying on the judgment, you should know the judgment in and out. When I'm asking you a question, regarding S. Vardarajan, show me where that point is in your favor, where it is. Just don't say, yes, he was acquitted in S. Vardarajan, so he needs to be acquitted over here. You have to compare each fact to your case, then only I'll be convinced or the judge will be convinced. Because you don't compare each fact of S. Vardarajan to your case and actually show every finding, then only the whole thing. If not, then we'll learn the provisions of law and argue and then find other judgments regarding that point. Apart from that, ethics, court ethics, guy, you're telling the court, you only said like that. Twice you said it. I ignored the first time, second time. you should know how to address the court. I understand in the first year, I don't expect it to be very good, and this has to be a learning experience only. It need not be something to get some achievements. It has to be a learning experience. So try to learn from all these mistakes you're making. I will be sharing the marks also, means when I was around, so they'll be sharing the marks. So see where you your marks were less, because you have to improve on those aspects. You cannot not, you have to, because there are many, many, many mistakes, which minute mistakes you're making, but those only come up with experience. I don't expect you to be this, like suddenly argues perfectly. This is the only way you are going to learn. Don't lose, don't demoralize yourself.
Sure,
so that is one thing. Apart from that, when the court is, try to pick up the hints when the judge is asking, he's trying to give you a hint. You are not picking that up. The judge is purposely trying to make you argue in one direction. So he will be, it will be clear in his head. You're arguing so the judge can give justice to your client. It's not because you're prepared for this moot you argue. You're trying to get justice for your client. So try to take the hints. You're trying to make, convince the judge that your client is innocent. Don't convince yourself. I hope you're understanding what I mean. So that is what, that's CC1, CC2. Also similar points. I asked you a question, rebuttal. You should have at least told me I don't want to answer. I don't know. You didn't reply also. I'd asked you to answer a question of mine in the rebuttal.
Okay. Sorry, sir. I thought only speaker one should speak at the time of rebuttal.
Why? When I asked you a question, you could ask me at least. What is your name? Which year are you in?
I'm from first year. My name is Neha Jogrekar.
Okay. Right. So when you are in the first year. So take the learning experience, the judge, get the organizers, or request the organizers, can I answer the judge's query, if you think so. When a judge has asked you a query, he has specifically asked you, so he can do that. I'm going to be marking all of you all. So I need to know how to mark all of you all. So now you are responding right now. Now I don't know what is your response to my question. So these small things, please note down. You have to learn these things, and these things you'll only learn with experience. No one is good in the first time. So remember these small things. Don't get use it as a demoralizing thing. Even DD1 and DD2, can you all introduce yourselves and what year you all are from?
Yes, sir.
Sorry?
Yes.
DD1 is from third year. And DD2?
DD1. I'm from first year.
Okay, I'm from first year. And DD2?
Yeah. First year, sir.
Fourth year?
First year.
So all four of you are first year. Okay, very good. So then this, all of you now have to help each other out. In fact, if you all want to have a discussion with each other, where you all thought the other side was wrong, where you all thought the arguments were bad, talk to your colleagues. I think this is being live-streamed also. So see your mistakes, what all mistakes you all have made. And DD1 and DD2, if you all don't know the judgment, don't cite it. And firstly, that is a wrong approach. Why don't you all know the judgment? You'll have to know. Why don't you all know the facts of the judgment?
We were aware of the court
ethics were very bad. Sorry, 1 minute. I'll just tell you. Again, court ethics was very bad. Yeah, tell me. What were you saying?
We were aware of the facts. It was just that it was our first time and we got confused and all that.
So then you should say that. Give me 1 minute. I gave you time in the rebuttal. Then you said you have given only half the judgment. That is an insult to the court.
Hmm.
You're telling the court, I don't want to tell you basically what you asked me. I don't want to answer your question. You have to understand how you are looking, how you are presenting yourself. It's all about presentation. At the end of the day, it's all about presentation. Don't get nervous. And you saw your colleague. You saw your colleague was arguing. You picked up the points which are. You picked up the same points. Same point which she argued, you only argued. As I said, don't narrate the facts. Same facts you are narrating again. 4 times I heard the same facts. All four of you will narrate the facts. You all cannot argue only on facts. What are legal position? Not one legal aspect you have argued on. Why Vardharajan was wrong? It could be a stupid argument, but at least put it forward. Don't not put it forward. You have to argue it. You can't not argue it. And even if you think, and you read it as a normal human being, as a just a citizen of the country, and see now, okay, this is wrong. I don't think so. How can someone take away a girl from the guardianship? And your where's DD1? She started well. Why did she get so flustered? You got scared.
Yes, sir.
Your point was proper. It is immaterial. What your argument was, voluntariness or force is immaterial to 361. Elaborate on that. Even CC1 and I gave you in rebuttal a chance to talk on mens rea. Should argue on mens rea. All these concepts you have to learn now. take this as a learning experience and lots more to improve upon for y'all. I don't want to just give y'all compliments as y'all did well. I don't want to unnecessarily, you know, say that, because I expected a little better performance from all of you. Overall, it was not a bad attempt. It was a good attempt. All of you have studied. I saw your, but it seemed like little half-hearted attempts. You need to give better attempts from next time.
Yes, sir.
Is that clear? Any yes, queries sir. You all have about the case, about how to argue?
Sir, can I ask something?
Yes.
You mentioned mens rea. In the facts, it is given that Balchandra was well aware that she is 17 years old. Also, she would be celebrating her 18th birthday a few months later. Then too, he proposed her for marriage, and he was. It is a known fact that someone, a girl who is under 18 years of age, isn't entitled to get married until unless she is 18. So then too, he took her out of the guardianship and he got married to her. So.
That is a point of mens rea, but there's a more interesting point to this that we can see his mens rea. But the more interesting, if you read 361, there's no question of mens rea. There's no mens rea required. All you'll do is take away a minor from the lawful guardianship. That's all you need to do. Once you take away the minor, you might not have an intention also taking away the minor. The fact that you've taken out taken the minor away from the lawful guardianship is enough to constitute the offense. And that should have been your argument. Okay. Have you understood? And what is
yes,
it? Is
sir.
It an appeal or is it a revision under 397? None of you have done it. It is a revision. This appeal is not maintainable. There's no appeal provided. The trial was not conducted in a sessions court or any other court. The trial was conducted in a magistrate court. There's no appeal from her order of a sessions court confirming the order of the magistrate court. Read the entire chapter 29 or whatever it is for appeals. There's no provision for that. You have to file a revision under 397. So please note that. In case you'll proceed to the next round, make sure I'll argue this point.
Yes.
Sure, sir.
Yes,
sir.
Okay. I'll just mark y'all and I'll let y'all know the results. Give me 5 minutes.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I know. I believe that was the procedure we followed on the last occasion. Okay, I didn't tell them the marks. But I'll send you the marks so you can total them before I reveal the results.
Yes. I will introduce our today's judge. After having such a great real feeling of courts on a virtual platform, thanks to our today's judge, who was always known as a versatile character, whether it's academics, co-curriculars, leadership, or any cultural programs or anything. There is actually a long list, but I would like to mention.
Yeah, please don't waste everyone's time. You can give a short introduction.
Yes.
TV is not for our college students. It's for other people.
Yes, sir, sure. So importantly, when he was in his academics, he passed his 10th with 92%. Also, he completed his college from Ruya, Ramadevas Ruya College, with the first class from science side. He completed, he was our ex-student and has completed his BLS LLB. From our college in 2017 with a first class credit. And at the same time, importantly, he topped an evidence act in entire university. He completed his cyber law from our college and he did his master's in constitutional and administrative law. He participated in various moot court competitions, debate, litigation, mock trials, and many others. Many of them he won. Importantly, Advocate Datta Pati Moot Court competition where he won, and at the same time he won the Best Speaker Award. He got the Best Speaker in KC Moot also. Many if we talk about he has worked off our college for 2 consecutive years. At the same time, Moot Court member student council for all the 5 years. So it was important skills of social, you know, I have a social skill, which I feel he was highly gifted and he's a real life example of having a social skill in because with the curricular, he also was taking part in many dramas, plays, short films, and participated in university level football competition. He presented at college over there. So, sir, it is really great to have you here today.
Thank you. Thank you so much. And,
shall we give the results now?
Aarti and Nurita, I've sent you all this marks. Just kindly total them.
Yes.
Sir?
Yes?
From which field you have done your graduation from Roya College?
Which year?
No. From which field? Like statistics?
I'm from science field.
I am also for science field only. Like I'm asking this, the course, like which BSc in which what?
No. I did my 12th HSC from
okay.
Roya. So I was doing my medicine. Yeah, I gave my PCB CET also. But then I wasn't very keen on medicine, so I decided to law.
Okay, I thought you have done your graduation because I did my graduation from there.
Okay. Good. No, I was in Roya only for 2 years, 11th and 12th. But then I joined this college only. What have you done yours in?
BSc Statistics.
Statistics. Then you are doing the 3-year course now?
Yes, sir. I just changed my field.
Very good. Law is welcoming for all professions.
Yes.
Anyone can do that. Law is open for all professions. After any profession, you can do an NLB degree. It can always come of use. Nurita Aarti, I'm sending you all the total, just confirm them. Huh?
Yes, sir.
I'm ready the results as long as you all have confirmed them, the totals. I think there's one change, huh? In the third one? Yeah. Reduced by one, right? Yeah, I confirmed on this. May I announce the result? Yes.
Yes, sir.
So, it wasn't much of a difference, but with a narrow margin, CC1 and CC2, you all have attained secured higher marks than DD1 and DD2.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. Congrats to everyone. And please keep working hard. Take assistance of your seniors and take assistance of any people you know. So you will keep working. Don't let this be the only moot you participate. I hope you all participate in more moots. And I hope to see you all and I hope to judge you all with a better performance from all of you all.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I'd like to present the vote of thanks. On behalf of all, I would like to thank our today's judge, Advocate Sir, for being here and inviting us with such great information. I would also like to thank our Principal Professor Varshali Guru Ma'am and our Faculty in Charge Professor Prani Sahu Ma'am and our participant. Please, if you all participate and keep your phones in any such competition, we are conduct. So thank you all. At the same time, I'm gonna send you one feedback form on your mail. So please fill it so that we'll be able to do the necessary changes for the next round. Thank you so much, all of you. Please be safe. And thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye bye. See you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, sir.
Bye. Thank you, sir.